All right. Well, Happy New Year, everybody. It's been a couple weeks. Usually we do this every other week, but with how the holidays fell this year, we actually haven't been together since I think it was like December 7th or something like that. So, but hope everybody had great holidays, whatever you celebrate and in any way that you've done. So I think that I've never seen more glad to see the year turn the page. Text messages and cards and emails and blow up 2020s and all of those types of things for good reason, because we were in what we've never been in before, is a massive pandemic throughout the world that obviously interrupted life that was normal as we know it, as well as a number of other things that happened last year. So tonight is actually going to focus on that topic, and I'll hand things off to Trent to kick it off. And we're really fortunate to have Robert Dintruff as a guest on tonight, who I'll introduce more thoroughly. But, you know, we're going to be talking about the pandemic and specifically the vaccinations. The vaccine is out. It's amazing, in my opinion, that we actually have a vaccine that has been released in 2020, within 9 months of this pandemic truly taking stage. So it really is a medical marvel in a lot of ways that we have a vaccine available to help us with the pandemic. Before we get into that, I thought we could let Trent do his thing and get us into the cultural mindset that he does such a great job of.
Well, first of all, Dr. Matta, I mean, it is 2021 and you said you were going to throw it to me, and then you said like 40 more things. So I want you to put that on your list. You know, when you actually do turn it over to somebody, actually turn it over to them. Okay.
Fair enough.
That was a little shot there. I haven't seen you in a while, man. I got to get him in. But actually, Dr. Matta, you should be very proud of yourself, because, you know, the Between the Chairs series, we are now in season 2 officially, okay? And this is episode 1, January 7th of 2021. So maybe Netflix will pick us up here soon. They know that Robert's on and Vinny's on. They might pick us up, and we can be right next to Oak Island, which is one of my favorite shows, okay? But I did go back in time, Dr. Matta, and the other doctors that are out there listening, and our operations experts. You're going to think this is kind of bizarre, but it was the Art and Science of Dentistry from the American Dental Journal, volume 12, January 7th. Now, it's exactly today.
Wow.
From 1915. So the only person on the call that could have referenced this probably would have been Dr. Ed Eves. However, oh, there was another one. Sorry, Ed, I couldn't resist. But
you're full of piss and vinegar on this in 2021 already.
Already, I sit in my little room all day and do that. I have some people interaction. But anyway, back to the serious nature of my point. This is the declaration of the American Dental Journal in 1915. Now there's about 6 or 7 bullet points. And I want you to listen closely, everyone, to what they were thinking 105 years ago. They were devoted to the advancing of the art and science of dentistry. They wanted to arouse a deeper conception of our duty to the public. They wanted to instill a broader and more advanced professional spirit to dentistry. They wanted to aid and elevate the plane of dental organizations. The American Dental Journal was there to support the state boards in executing state laws. They were there to lend assistance to the worthy and ethical practitioners. They wanted to institute a library in college to extend courses beyond basic dental school. They wanted to point a way to life's balance towards entertainment, recreation, and rest. They wanted to instruct in the science of the proper building of practices and how to interact with the public. And finally, they wanted to bring their message to the larger audience of their communities. I feel that that's exactly what we're trying to do, Dr. Matta. Matter of fact, the art and science of dentistry, I think we've taken it a step further. Let's get the word art out of there and let's replace it with heart. Because I believe back in March 13th. We all say that date into April. And I know that Robert's been helping us through this process since April, that we really have extended our heart and we had to open our minds on how can we help the industry of dentistry? How can we help our teammates? How can we help our patients? How can we get through this shutdown through a pandemic in unprecedented times? So I feel that North American Dental Group, along with the Professional Dental Alliance, Dr. Matta, has changed dentistry because we lead with our heart and we use science to help us understand what we need to do to be the best practitioners, to help our teammates and protect them in safety. And of course, what can we do to get through COVID-19 with the vaccinations and getting through that process? So Dr. Matta, if you'd be so kind to introduce our two panelists this evening. They've been with us for a while. One is a partner, and Robert has helped us understand the nuances of COVID-19. Dr. Matta, the floor is yours.
Awesome. Yeah, tonight we want to get right into the topic. The updates, again, this is a new year, it's a new page. So there couldn't be more exciting things going on this year. We've got, you know, a ton of momentum in things like education, implant mastery. We've got some cool initiatives going on with digital technology. We're going to get into those in future sessions. But tonight we thought it would be best to focus on the vaccination. It's something that is front of mind for everybody. It's the entire population has questions about the vaccination. There's anxieties in, you know, with some, and there is just really a lot of information that, as again, the, between the chairs is meant for us as clinicians and providers to be able to keep updated and keep current with relevant topics. And there's not more a more relevant topic than the vaccination. But just even beyond the vaccination, we have been working hard in North American Dental Group to really look at this pandemic and be proactive with our response to it. Early on, we were looking at, okay, this virus is spreading, it's highly contagious, understanding that things were shut down, essential care, all of those things that we went back and had to navigate in March and April, wondering, are we going to have to validate that everybody in a practice has tested negative to have a staff member or a team member there or a patient come in the office? Started to look at testing. Kristen Kearns was, or is, a graduate at Kellogg's MBA Business School, at their Graduate School of Business, which is a part of Northwestern University. She had the privilege to have being a student of Robert Dintruff, as he, and I'll let him speak to it, but was doing some very interesting things with their students there, taking them to Africa on a trip, being able to expose them to, you know, just different things that were occurring to compete with the HIV virus and doing things to in prevention and otherwise navigating virology in Africa and otherwise. So we were introduced to Robert through Kristen, and he was able to be a consultant to us to be able to give us advice on testing at the time, and then has continued to stay on weekly calls with a small task team, myself, Rodney, and Vinny, as well as others at different times, have come onto a call weekly with Robert just to get updates from him, how he understands his expertise and true ability to navigate what's going on has been really instrumental for us in helping us to really frame how we're going to navigate different things that we've implemented. One thing that we have done recently as we're preparing to kind of talk about the vaccination, we have, as you know, put through test pilot offices, testing modalities. We've continued to advance that. And most currently at my practice, I have, you know, gone through getting a CLIA permit, gone through getting a lab permit, and, you know, certain states have advocated for dentists and other healthcare professionals to be able to support the distribution and administering the vaccine to help to get this through the population as efficiently as possible. We've positioned the practice that I see patients in to register our practice. And I've just spoken to the Department of Health several times this week and have been recognized and effectively approved to be a site to be able to administer vaccinations. And we'll be doing that for patients according to whatever category they may sit in, as well as team members, et cetera, hopefully as soon as next week. But we'll kind of know more about that in coming days. So it's important that we are continuing to be an advocate and being able to do our part as clinicians. But most importantly is that we understand what's going on and we can speak confidently and educated about it. So with that said, I'd like to introduce Robert Dintruff. I'd like you to, you know, add to this, but of course your work experience has been, I believe, since 1979 with Abbott Laboratories, and spent a really long and involved career with Abbott, you know, in multiple different parts, but most recently prior to stepping away and you know, doing more time at Northwestern University through Abbott International and the director of commercial development and responsible for programs in the virology and divisions in the international aspects of things. And I think you can kind of explain a little bit more of some of the work you did. So with that said, you know, Robert, thank you again for all the work you've helped us with over the last several months and for joining us tonight and being able to give us some guidance here as clinicians.
Well, that's fantastic. Dr. Mata, thank you very much. I appreciate the introduction, and I hope I can live up to all you've said here. By way of my background, it is correct that I have spent my entire career with Abbott Laboratories, about 35 years. I did also spend about the last 15 or 20 years now, including some time at Northwestern, working largely on HIV, working on adjusting technology to fit an African environment, worked a lot in infectious diseases, and also sought to encourage a new generation to get engaged in public health and global health at Northwestern. So each year we've sought, with of course the exception of 2020, to take a group of 25 or 30 students over to Africa and give them an experiential learning environment where they could get a good feel for just how complex an area like this can be. And then of course, as we moved into COVID-19, we had to pivot a little bit. And so we started to include a lot of essential parts of dealing with coronavirus in not only our teaching, but also in some of the consulting work that I've been doing. Okay. So these are just my disclosures. And I want to start by actually talking a little bit about the two disciplines that have brought us to where we are with regard to COVID-19, immunology and molecular biology. They help us not only in the development of a vaccine, but in a lot of the diagnostic work that has been required through this process. They will help us a little bit further when it comes to understanding how well the vaccines are working with antibody testing. So I'll get to that in a moment. But the first part of this is really, and the most visible part to a lot of people, has been PCR testing. And there are basically two approaches there. There's sort of a thermocycling approach, which is the most sensitive. It's the central lab test. It's a slow turnaround. It's quite frankly, an area where we saw a backlog occur. Because it's a more complex test, it takes time. And it's also one that is relatively expensive. Then we started to see some of these isothermal technologies come out that were faster, they were a bit more portable, and they still used some instrumentation, but it wasn't quite as complex. Both of these approaches are reasonably sensitive, the thermocycling being a bit more sensitive, but both are very specific. So you don't end up with a lot of false positive results. And then along comes antigen testing. These tests are typically lateral flow technologies. They are faster, they're less sensitive, and they're the least expensive approach. And what we're working on right now is the development of ways to achieve all of these things: quality, speed, ease of use, and reduced complexity and lower cost, all in one package. And so that will likely come with PCR testing that is done in ways that are simplified a bit and modified so that they're just that much faster and more available to us. And then ultimately here, I think we're going to see antibody testing come up. Right now, we have very limited options for rapid detection, but hopefully this will begin to emerge a bit further as we get into more vaccinations. One thing that I wanted to mention, just because there's a fair amount of confusion to this, is the way things have progressed. We have two different tests with two different levels of sensitivity here. And so that has been something that sort of created some confusion. There are areas, and I hope you can see my pointer here, a little triangle over here and a little one here, where the higher sensitivity and the ability to detect lower viral load levels allows us to get a positive result with a PCR test, but a negative result with the antigen tests. And so what we encounter from that is a fair amount of confusion. And it's important to understand that what we're really interested in is being able to detect when someone is in fact infectious. And so the antigen tests actually do that reasonably well. And the PCR test will do it even better up front, but they also pick up these fragments that we're not really all that interested in, and they call them positive results.
What are you seeing right now? Because there's a lot of different testing that's going on. Somebody says, hey, I went and got tested, and we have somebody that has had some sort of exposure to somebody else, and they go get tested and think they're good because they're negative. You know, how long is that window until an antigen might show up, or like you're showing here, a negative test? And this is why we continue with our protocol of, you know, if you've had a high risk exposure, regardless of what a test may show, you know, there's a certain period of time, now it's 7 days, I believe, that regardless of a test, you still have to isolate. Are we seeing more antigen tests out in the field right now? Or is this example that you just indicated the reasoning for that?
We are seeing more antigen tests. They are easier to produce. They're being produced by the millions, as many as 50 million tests a month now. And so that's in essence what's starting to drive this. The problem with them is, and it's, I hope, a relatively minor one, is that they often give false positive results, particularly in circumstances where the incidence is very low. Roughly 15 out of 1,000 people will have a false positive result with one of these tests. And that's why when they did the studies with these tests, they chose a population that was symptomatic for the most part. And so in fact, they didn't include anybody in the study that had a start of symptoms earlier than 7 days prior to the point of being tested. So that's one factor. Now, what we have to remember here is that there's an incubation period and there's a latency period. And the incubation period is from the point at which someone is infected to the point where they realize symptoms. The latency period goes from the point where the person is infected to the point where they are able to infect others and are in fact infectious. And that's a tight window in this particular case, but the point there is that some people can start spreading the disease before we would be able to actually detect them. And that becomes one of the complications that we have to be aware of. It is very possible to have someone that has some symptoms and tests negative, and in a short period of time becomes detectable by some of these tests. And
so in a nutshell, they're infecting others. They show up as potentially negative on a test. A false positive is less likely, but the risk of a false positive is, hey, I was positive and I have to isolate and do that, and that's inconvenient to that person. Mm-hmm. A false negative, I think in our society, is a little bit riskier because I think people have a false sense of confidence that they're safe and they're going about communicating with other people thinking they're okay.
That's exactly right. And to address the convenience issue with regard to a false positive result, what's been recommended is that when a positive result comes up on an antigen test, it's routine to retest that person by PCR, mm-hmm. just to be sure that they are in fact positive and it's not one of these false positives.
Rob, can you please explain? So what are we actually testing for from the antigen test versus the molecular test? What makes it different?
Great question. And the answer to it is simply this. There is no test for SARS-CoV-2. It doesn't exist. What exists is a test for a strand of genetic material that is unique to SARS-CoV-2. I make that distinction because you're very specifically looking at SARS-CoV-2 when you get a positive result by PCR. It clearly is positive, unless there's been some cross-contamination or something of that nature. So that's what you're actually testing for. With an antigen test, you're looking for the antigen itself, and you're using antibodies to do that. So in effect, you're developing a test that will create a line and a lateral flow strip when you have, in fact, the virus present in the sample. And that's all you're doing at that point is utilizing that technology to identify not something at a molecular level, but something that is recognizing that the antigen is there by use of antibodies. Moving on from there then, to talk about the different approaches in vaccines. This is a cartoon that shows three different approaches. Let's start with the third one, since that came out first. The vaccines that we see from Pfizer, BioNTech, and also Moderna. Here we're utilizing mRNA, which codes for the spike protein. So you're simply injecting mRNA in a lipid and using that to have the body produce spike protein. Then the body goes through the typical immune system process to produce antibodies that are protective. Another approach to do it would be that of, say, J&J, who's making progress with their vaccine and one other, where you start with a spike protein and utilize an adenovirus. As an example, a virus that would be infectious to a chimpanzee, but not to a human. And by approaching it that way, the body then produces the spike protein with the help of that adenovirus and proceeds from there with the immune response. And then the final approach, which is one that Novavax is using, is to just purify and inject the spike protein itself and have that produce the immune system. So we have these three different approaches. And the one that has been a little concerning to some people has been these mRNA vaccines because they're relatively new. We've never really taken this approach before. So that is certainly something to consider there.
Rob, yep. Can you briefly explain the difference between an attenuated viral vaccine and what the differences from injecting mRNA versus injecting actual attenuated virus?
Right. We're not doing that with COVID-19. Nobody's using a live virus or a weakened virus or anything of that sort to create an immune response. But we use this sort of a surrogate, if you will, this adenovirus to do that replicative work for us. So that is the means by which the body will produce the spike protein. Now you can go with spike protein on its own. You can have this other virus do it for you, or you can give it the instructions for your body to produce the spike protein, as you see in line three, and have that actually create the spike protein and then an antibody response to it. So as you are then later exposed to the virus, you've got the antibody system there already to protect you from it. We currently do not have any vaccines approved for COVID-19. All of them are this emergency use authorized vaccines. And I think that bothers some people that this was all done so rapidly. So I want to start by talking about that a little bit. Specifically, how the review process has been streamlined for COVID-19 vaccines. There are a lot of parts to this. The first of them is that there wasn't a lot of waiting at the FDA to do this. They jumped to the front of the queue when these submissions were made. The second factor was that urgency really ruled the process here. As with HIV, and this is the only other place I've really seen this occur, the FDA really considered the benefits to be had versus some of the risks. And in the case of HIV, there were many people around the country saying at that time back in the 1980s and early 90s, when we were trying to get drugs approved, that we don't care if they're safe and effective, we're gonna die anyway. And so we wanna take the risk on of trying these various antiretroviral drugs that were coming out. So we saw that, and the FDA responded to that, and they've essentially done it again here, but they've really limited the risks that are being taken here from what I can see. So the third thing is special instructions were issued to describe what manufacturers have to do in order to apply for emergency use authorization so that mistakes wouldn't be made in the process that would delay it. Next, there was accelerated recruitment of subjects for the trials. There was also the utilization of experts with access to preliminary data so that there were no surprises for the FDA reviewers. Then, as usual, it went to the ACIP, which is the Advisory Committee on Immunization Practices, and they still reviewed each of these submissions. By the way, when you make a submission like this to the FDA, it's big deal. It doesn't go in an envelope. It sits on a pallet. I mean, it is literally reams of documentation that the FDA often wants to see for various things, whether it's a drug or a test or a vaccine. There's a lot of work that you have to do to get there. I think that it's safe to say that the FDA was a little bit more cautious about asking for additional information in this process. You know, a lot of times they'll see something happen with a couple of patients and they'll wonder, should we investigate this a little further and so forth. I don't know if the FDA was a little less willing to do that than they had been at points in the past, but it certainly didn't seem like there was anything of that nature that delayed the process in any way. So the only thing that we're really seeing is that some of the long-term data that we might like to see is not present. So I'll leave it at that. But you can see, I think bottom line on it is that we can feel pretty comfortable about this approval process. There were not a lot of shortcuts, but there were some things that were accelerated in a way that I think made sense.
So Rob, when they were doing their fact-finding and evidence-proving process through the FDA, the cohort was not huge, but fairly large. It was around 40,000 people that were in the cohort, which makes it pretty powerful with a decent N. And from a safety perspective, do you think that they did due diligence and produced a vaccine, which they're reporting at 94% effectiveness and 95% effectiveness is appropriate and safe for the community?
I think the numbers are reasonable. There's no simple mathematical approach that can tell you what your numbers have to be, because people, remember what we're trying to do here is inject in a double-blind placebo-controlled study some people with the actual virus and some people with the placebo. So we have to wait then and see if there's a significant difference between those who ultimately come down with COVID-19 and those who, among those who come down with COVID-19, which were given the placebo and which were given the actual vaccine. And that's all blinded. So we do that and then we wait until we get a significant number. That number improves as these studies continue, although I don't know that anybody, I haven't seen any data released to that effect showing larger numbers. But generally speaking, when you get up to the point where you've got 100 people that came down with COVID and when the vast majority of those were in the placebo group, it's a pretty good indication that your vaccine has had a reasonable effect. But I think there we have to kind of trust how these studies are powered. And that is, of course, something that the FDA looks at very closely before it makes a determination about moving forward.
So Robert, and this might be also for you, Dr. Correo, there was two questions posed in the chat. One was, and we'll stay with the second one because it's around the vaccination. The other was on testing, so we can go back to downstream. Just to a note about children and teenagers having a different physiology than adults, and how does the inoculation of them, how does that differ, resulting in this? And I understand that I believe Moderna is approved on individuals over 18 and Pfizer over 16. I'm not sure if I'm accurate with that, but
that's correct.
Any comments on children and teenagers?
I can tell you from the standpoint of the studies that are being done, Pfizer has very recently stepped in there to do a study in somewhat younger patients, subjects, I should say. And so that is being conducted now. But obviously, this is the group that we find to be less vulnerable to severe complications. But it's also a group that's somewhat harder to always study. And I think there's a lot of hesitancy in enrolling your children in a trial of that sort. And of course, the same thing applies, that's my next point here, regarding pregnant women, but we can talk about that in a minute. I'll let Dr. Correo make some comments if he wishes.
Yeah, so I agree with Rob. You know, it's very difficult if you're going to get a cohort of children and put them in an experimental path. It's a difficult hurdle. But as we know from the virus, that it doesn't really affect children as virulent as it does other patients. And part of that is from the fact that the virus is more virulent and possibly, producing poor outcomes and fatal outcomes in patients that have immunodeficiencies or other comorbidities. Whereas children, for the most part, are healthy and their immune systems are very, very strong and are always on the move and taking on all antigens that come their way. So I think they do have a stronger fortified immune system and have less chance of being having a fatal effect. Although they can get infected and have flu symptoms, but it's at a much lower rate. The thing that you need to be careful of is there are obviously children that do have some severe disease processes. And the one that comes to mind are patients that have leukemia, where their immune systems are very, very low. And if they were exposed to corona, they would have the same outcomes as some of the older patients and patients who have comorbidities. So I think from two perspectives, one is it's hard to, like Rob had said, it's hard to do a study and have a cohort of children. But secondly, in this case with COVID, I think the immune systems that support children that are healthy have less problems if they were infected with corona. So I think that that's an important point.
Yeah. And then we got another question, but thanks, Vin and Robert, for those answers. I think that's actually very helpful in clarifying kind of where it sits right now for individuals under really 16. So one of the doctors asked, other than mRNA vaccine being new technology, is there any other direct concern with it?
Well, we don't have a lot of experience with mRNA vaccines, and so we don't know how well they last over the long term. But I don't want to get ahead of ourselves here. I don't think we have any reason to believe one way or the other in terms of the duration of protection. So we're just going to need to wait and see on that part of it. I think we have had some experience in the area of Ebola with this vaccine, but it's been very, very limited and the numbers are very low. This is something that has come about at the right time. And we're all very hopeful. All signs indicate that it's safe and effective enough to get emergency use authorization. First of all, with pregnant women, they were not included in any of the trials, but it should be noted that the American College of Obstetrics and Gynecology says that the vaccine, or suggests that the vaccine, should not be withheld. I'll leave that one as it is. I did want to talk also about access to vaccines. Obviously, we have a lot of issues here with cold chain requirements and the fact that we've got various inventory points from a distributor to the federal, to the state level, to the county level, to a facility level, and even down to private facilities and pharmacies and things like that sort. Somebody got very optimistic when they said we'd have 20 million people vaccinated by the end of December. And I think that it's going to move along and start moving along much more quickly. Hopefully we will find that with all the pressure that's coming on, that the numbers in January are more indicative of what our run rate will be for vaccinations moving forward. One of the things that's also been discussed there that I'll mention, there's concerns about waste and utilization of the vials within an allotted time frame because we're pulling multiple vaccinations from a single vial in many cases with these vaccines. And but there's just, I think, a general tendency to overestimate the complexity of the supply chain that we have and the complications associated with delivering these vaccines. Last couple of points here really quickly. You should be aware, and you may be hearing some things about delaying the second dose of a vaccine for people. People are looking at this and saying, with a vaccination where the first jab gets you about an 80% response rate, isn't it better to do 100 million people with one shot rather than 50 million people, or let's say 100 million, to rephrase it. Is it better to give 50 million people 90% or 100 million people, 80% response. And that's a reasonable question. It's just something that we'll have to watch. There's some people that feel strongly that the evidence that we have doesn't suggest that this is a good idea, or we simply don't know. Others are starting to talk about it in very practical terms that way. So I'll leave it at that. The only other thing that I wanted to say was that we are starting to see several of these systems being put in place by various state governments. In New York is an example that I'm using here. You can go to the website that I've shown. You click on a button that says, am I eligible? And it allows you to specify that you're a person in a patient-facing healthcare setting, and that will prioritize you for a vaccine. And it also specifies exactly where we stand, who is it that's being vaccinated at the present time.
Well, I will get into some of the questions. One was posted in the chat around, you know, additional risks. But before I get there, maybe we'll stay for one more second on this distribution pattern. And you kind of mentioned it starts at federal. And again, I think it's fair just to remind that, you know, it seems fairly unlikely that we would have had a vaccine in 2020. So the fact that we had two, and then we have a couple others on the horizon, maybe for a second, just speak about, all right, so we know Pfizer's has an EUA, Moderna has an EUA, right? Those are the two. Just for a second, what do we see on the horizon? Do we see a likelihood of others being approved for EUA and distribution?
Yes, we have the AstraZeneca vaccine coming. That's been going through approvals in Europe, or authorizations in Europe. And the other one that is moving along comes from Johnson & Johnson. I know of some people who are in the J&J trials. And so that's been moving along. There's discussion that they'd be ready to apply for some authorization as early as January or February. So that one's moving along pretty quickly.
Yeah, and also Novavax is the other one that's going to be, I think, on the horizon also.
Yeah, which one is the one that's the in partnership with Oxford? Is that AstraZeneca? Or is
AstraZeneca,
that
yes.
Okay, yeah. Because I was speaking with Dr. Coyle, who's one of our colleagues in Europe and in England, and that seems to be already being distributed quite readily throughout England is the AstraZeneca one with Oxford.
Yeah, so interestingly enough, there are some vaccines that are approved in China and Russia that are not approved here. And probably because they're using the actual virus, inactivated or a peptide vaccine, which I think makes it difficult, because if you're going to infect people with the virus itself, you know, there is an ability there for people who have immunodeficiencies to have a poor outcome. And so that's why I don't think the FDA has even looked at them closely to say that they're approved.
Right. So, Dr. Mata, what I'm trying to show here is just very quickly where these vaccines are. Novavax is one. There's been a little bit of delay in the Sanofi GSK vaccine, but otherwise these are the key ones.
And I'd love to actually circulate this spreadsheet. You've shared this with me. You continue to update it. And I think it's really helpful. It allows us to understand where things are today. What are some of the criteria? So that table that you just showcased, if you don't mind, I would love to share it with our doctors so that they can kind of have an idea of where things sit today. And we'll make sure to get that out, because I'm sure that question will come up. But essentially, it's the different vaccines, where things are today. And this distribution going through the states to the counties, you know, I know there's a lot of criticism on things. I look at it as, you know, I just have this eagerness, like we just got to keep getting it out. Like it's one of my passions is to continue to put us as dentists in a position to be able to administer them. We understand how to give an injection. We understand how to manage emergency complications. We understand, you know, pharmacology. We also have a responsibility to do our part and to understand the logistics of the vaccine. We can't just inject something or deliver a medication into anybody. And part of the reason for tonight's topic is we need to be understanding of everything that is to be able to respond to our patients, but also to put each of ourselves in a position that, if able to, can help facilitate distributing this, you know, throughout the country. I think our patients, it's a great access point.
Yeah, and I think that's very important to be proactive, as you have been in your practice. Simply seek out the connections that allow you to be in a position to do testing or vaccinations as appropriate.
Right, because it won't be long before the entire population is at least eligible, right? And that will allow us to facilitate. And we see senior citizens, we see all ages in our practices. One of the questions that comes, so if we can spend a couple of the minutes maybe on some of the additional risks that we've heard, maybe some of the anxieties. One individual asked, can the vaccine decrease fertility in women?
So I'll comment on the clinical stuff. So far with all the vaccines, the common side effects have been flu-like symptoms, fever, chills, pain at the injection site, erythema, and they usually last for 1 or 2 days. And that's really it. The kind of red flag are patients who've had bad reactions or anaphylactic type reactions to the flu virus or any other or flu vaccine or any of the vaccines that have been given, they get a little bit of a red flag. I've heard some other stuff on the internet about people who had injectables that would get infected or have inflammation at the site of an injectable, such as Juvederm or a Restylane or one of those things. So there's no proof to that. There's no evidence. There's no research, I think, that leads to those conclusions. And you know, the OBGYNs are saying it's okay to have the vaccine delivered. So I would say in general that it's a very safe thing to do. Just like in the past when they were accused, there was some accusations toward vaccines causing autism and things of that nature. There was never any proof, it was all anecdotal. So I think a lot of this fear and trepidation comes from maybe poor information.
Yeah, and I think we have to be careful not to get ahead of ourselves on this. We hear about variants that are out there, and there's all sorts of concerns about that, and things get blown up in the press about, oh my gosh, what have we got, another virus that's that much more infectious and it's going to not work with the vaccine and all of this kind of thing. There isn't a lot of evidence to suggest that. So if ever there was a time when we should be evidence-based, it's now.
Correct.
Well, that answers the next question that popped up is the new strains, how concerned or how comfortable can we be that the vaccine will create immunization to those? And it sounds like we just don't know yet.
Well, we don't know, but I think that what we are hearing is that there doesn't seem to be any impact on the spike protein, which is what is allowing you to neutralize the virus. So it doesn't appear as though that's going to be a problem. It certainly isn't right now.
Okay. I agree. Because if the protein is the same, which it should be, whatever that spike protein is that gets reproduced by our own cells and then is cloned and then the antigen is produced, should not be different if it's the same SARS virus, COVID-2.
I mean, it's natural to see this kind of mutation occurring.
Of
and of course, we saw it in HIV also. We have subtypes up through type N and O, I think, in HIV. Very different. It's a retrovirus and all of that, I understand. But this is what viruses do. They mutate to get around what would thwart them.
Yeah. Yeah, it was described that viruses effectively want to live, right? So they actually become somewhat less lethal so that they don't kill their host, and they become more contagious so that they can replicate. You know, that's their mutation and their evolution.
That's right. And that's their only job, is to make copies of themselves.
So we had a comment and we were talking about the distribution and Dr. Cannon, who, you know, he's always at the top of his game and proactive in our industry with he's been doing some really cool things with antiviral agents and things, which, you know, it was described as kind of a three-prong approach to dealing with competing with the virus. One is test to see if you have it, decreasing, you know, the spread, because hopefully you will isolate. The second is vaccinations. And the third is, let's not forget about antivirals. That was brought up actually at our board meeting from Alan Hipa, who is a board member at Roche Pharmaceutical. So it's good, the work that Dr. Cannon's doing. But he just did note that it is somewhat of a disappointment that, you know, some that are not categorized today as being high risk are finding a way to get the vaccination, and you know, we need to be continuing to prioritize those at high risk. So completely understand. And that's a reality that that there is. I think the bigger, and maybe Robert, you can comment to this, because it's just the one thing I have been seeing, but you know that things get exploited and embellished in the news, is the amount of waste of vaccinations. On some, I think, is a bit unfair because it comes in a 10-dose vial, right? So you get a vial of a certain amount of CCs, and if you can't use it in 5 to 6 hours, it's at that point, in effect, you have to dispose of it. So in order to have exactly 10 people in front of you, or factors of 10, it's fairly almost impossible. So are you going to have exactly 50 people that you saw in those 5 hours and opened exactly 5 vials? That's kind of unlikely. So I understand, but at the same time, if you're at that 3 doses left and you don't have 3 high-risk patients in front of you, we should be getting people vaccinated. Like, that's my opinion, but I don't know anybody else's thoughts here.
That's kind of what I've been hearing also, is the ethical thing is to more fully utilize the vaccine. You know, there's sensitivity around giving it to people who are not prioritized.
Yeah, so it's a real matter, you know, and hopefully we get to the point where we have enough supply to be able to service. And then it will then become the choke points, is how many people can actually administer it. And hospitals are treating patients, so they can only have so many other individuals come through their doors. So we need more access points. I'll continue to beat this drum because, you know, pharmacies are one, but we're professionals that can do this. And I'm excited to see some states authorizing dentists, and look forward to doing it in our test kitchens. And then we'll see from there on how to kind of go from there.
The only thing I would say is that looking at the science behind this, it's been a very exciting time, an interesting time to deal with this. We should never forget that this could have been a lot worse in many ways. But what we have in terms of technology today has really given us a leg up in managing this.
Yeah, my only final comment is I do think all healthcare practitioners should get the virus. I think we have the potential of spreading it from patients. I'm sorry.
Let's hopefully don't get the virus.
Well, same thing, right? No.
Right.
Sorry about that. So everyone should get the vaccine. And I think because we do see patients on a daily basis, and I think it's important to do. So I know there's trepidation, but don't be afraid to do it.
You know, it's actually a good way to bring things to a close. One thing I would like our doctors to be doing is to be a point of balance with the teams. There are some states that our team members are, you know, we're eligible in most states and it's fluid, but we're seeing a very low response rate to team members actually getting it. And I can only assume that it's because of that trepidation. So we want to be a voice of encouragement, you know, get the knowledge, get the understanding. That was the point of tonight's discussion, is so that we can, you know, be an advocate for this to our patients, to our team members. And it really is important that our doctors and that our dental assistants, our clinicians, and everybody that is in the office navigating patient care can be receiving this. And we want to encourage them to. So I think that's a great way to kind of end tonight, is we want to we have not mandated this. You know, everybody's, is it mandated? We are highly encouraging this. We really want to encourage it. We're doing everything we can to inform our team members of where they can get it. We have our call center, our patient service center repurposed to do outbound calls to our regional areas to be able to get team members set up with appointments at facilities that they can get the vaccinations, and really want our doctors to encourage their teams to be able to receive it. You know, Dr. Cannon just added in the chat that he's getting his second dose on Saturday, as well as some of the team members, and he is encouraging otherwise. So I really appreciate, Robert, you coming on and everything that you've done over the last several months, and look forward to talking regularly, you know, as you've continued to be a consult to our company and helping us to be, you know, proactive to the best we can. I really appreciate everything you've done for us.
Yeah, I'd like to thank you too, Robert. Great job.
It's been my pleasure. Thank you for having me.
You're a huge resource, huge.
And thank you, Vin, for your comments and coming on and all the work that you've been doing as well. And to everybody that participated, and then we have recorded this tonight, so we will be saving it and sharing it with the doctors and the company. And for those that think, you know, please share it with team members as well. It's helpful information. So have a great night. Thank you guys very much.
Okay. Thank you all. Bye now.